Members, shall we move now to the consideration stage of the Public Services Ombudsman's Bill? And I call the Chairperson of the Committee for the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, Mr Mike Nesbitt, to move the bill.
Mr Speaker, I move that the consideration stage of the Public Services Ombudsperson Bill be now taken.
Members will have a copy of the Marshall list of amendments detailing the order for consideration. The amendments have been grouped for debate in the provisional grouping of amendments selected list. There are three groups of amendments, and we will debate the amendments in each group in turn. The amendments in Group 1 deal with name changes and technical matters. The second debate will be on amendments relating to the powers and remit of the Ombudsperson. The third debate will be on amendments dealing with the complaints handling procedure. I remind members intending to speak that during the debates on the three groups of amendments, they should address all of the amendments in each group on which they wish to comment. Once the debate in each group is completed, any further amendments in the group will be moved formally as we go through the bill, and the question on each will be put without further debate. The questions in Sam's part will be taken at the appropriate points of the bill, and if that is clear, we shall proceed. And we now come to the first group of amendments for debate. With Amendment 1, it will be convenient to debate all of the other amendments in Group 1, along with the opposition to Clause 52, Stand Part. These amendments deal with name changes and technical matters. Members should note that Amendment 10 is consequential to Amendment 9. Amendment 130 is consequential to Amendments 1 and 76. Amendment 131 is consequential to Amendments 1, 76 and 130. As opposition to Clause 52 has been tabled by Mr Nesbitt as Chairperson of the Committee for the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, I call the Chairperson of the Ad Hoc Committee on the Public Services Ombudsperson Bill, the Lord Morrow, to move Amendment 1 and to address the other amendments in the group. Lord Morrow.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I beg to move Amendment 1. As Chairman of the former Ad Hoc Committee on the Public Services Ombudsperson Bill, I would like to take this opportunity to thank the members of the committee who provided evidence to the Committee for OFM DFM Bill team, supporting officials, and finally the committee's support team for the time and effort that they put into this bill and into the preparation of the committee's report. The Ad Hoc Committee, by its very nature, carried out its scrutiny of this bill in a relatively short period of time, and I am appreciative of the consideration paid by the members during this period. The aim of the bill is to combine the offices of the Assembly Ombudsman and the Commissioner for Complaints into a single office for public service complaints. The Northern Ireland Public Services Ombudsperson, or NIPSO, the bill not only combines the powers and remit of the existing offices, but also provides for appointment of the NIPSO on the nomination of the Assembly and for the NIPSO to report to the Assembly. While the committee didn't oppose any clauses or schedules in the bill in its consideration and was content with the amendments put forward by the Committee for OFM-DFM, prior to its formal clause-by-clause scrutiny, members did express concerns on a number of issues and also made recommendations for the Committee for OFM-DFM as sponsor of the bill and take steps to address the committee concerns. I will address these concerns through the course of the debate here today. With regard to Amendment 1, Mr Speaker, and the other amendments proposed by the Ad Hoc Committee, namely Amendments 76, 130 and 131, the committee is proposing that the title of the new office will be Public Service Ombudsman. The Ad Hoc Committee considered the usage of the term Ombudsperson in the bill as drafted and noted that the Committee for OFM-DFM's intention was that the name be unambiguously gender neutral. The committee noted the comments of the International Ombudsman Institute, the Ombudsman Association and the Welsh and Irish Ombudsman that the term is already gender neutral, is a trusted and recognised brand, and to change the title could cause confusion amongst the public. The committee noted the Scandinavian origin of the term and its original meaning in Swedish as representative. While initially some members of the committee preferred ombudsperson as an explicitly gender-neutral form, following consideration of a research paper on the etymology of the term, the committee agreed to propose amendments to change ombudsperson to ombudsman. There are over 200 instances of the word ombudsperson in the bill, and the committee seeking an efficient and practical means of effecting its amendments agreed that the committee would seek amendments to the first instance of the term in the bill, this is in clause 1, and to the short and long title at this consideration stage, depending on the outcome of today's proceedings, intends to table amendments to the other affected clauses for further consideration stage. I understand that the Committee for OFM DFM, as sponsor of the bill, is content with the ad hoc committee's amendments to change ombudsperson to ombudsman. With respect to Amendment 73, the ad hoc committee did not have sight of this amendment prior to the committee's formal clause-by-clause scrutiny and therefore does not have a view. Regarding the remaining technical amendments in this group proposed by the Committee for OFM-DFM, the ad hoc committee considered these amendments following briefings from the bill team and was content to agree them. The chairperson of the Committee for OFM-DFM will no doubt explain the intentions behind those amendments in his contribution to today's debate. With regards to Amendment 55 and the clause to which it relates, that is Clause 37, the Ad Hoc Committee considered this clause at length in its deliberations. Clause 37 provides the power for the NIPSR to lay a special report before the Assembly after conducting an investigation. It appears that the NIPSR that an injustice has been sustained and that the injustice has not been or will not be remedied or adequately remedied. The committee noted evidence welcoming this provision as a means of strengthening the office of the NIPSR, but also noted the concerns of representatives of the medical profession that such a power could be construed as coercive and have significant reputational impact, for example, for a general practitioner. The committee noted that the Ombudsman Northern Ireland Order 1996 provides for the laying of a special report before the Assembly. As at Clause 11, the committee noted stakeholder concerns with regard to potential implications of an ongoing judicial review and the laying of special reports. In considering legal advice on this issue, the committee noted that the judicial review relates to the Commissioner for Complaints Order and any decisions on powers exercisable under the Commissioner for Complaints cannot be read across the bill. The committee also noted that the NIPSO as a public authority will be required by Section 6 of the Human Rights Act 1998 to act in a manner which is compatible with rights under the European Convention on Human Rights, including Article 6, right to fair hearing, and Article 8, right to a private and family life, and to ensure that it discharges its functions in a manner which is procedurally fair. While the committee was content to agree Clause 37 and Amendment 55, it expressed its reservations in respect of the provisions in this clause for the NIPSO to lay a special report before the Assembly and was concerned that such a power could potentially be construed as coercive and that such a report had the potential to have a detrimental impact on a medical practitioner. Accordingly, the committee recommended that the Committee for OFM-DFM, as sponsor of the bill, satisfies itself that there are proper safeguards and procedural fairness before any such power is exercised. The committee noted that the Audit Committee is seeking resolution through a protocol with DFP and is seeking ministerial agreement to a memorandum of understanding between the Assembly and the Executive on the judgment process where such a protocol could be included. However, the Audit Committee is not aware that such a resolution is imminent and states that it is likely that, as currently drafted, paragraph 17 of Schedule 1 would allow for similar issues to arise in respect of the NIPSA and the judgment, the budget for the NIPSA's office. The committee sought the views of the Committee for OFM-DFM on concerns expressed by the Audit Committee. The Committee for OFM-DFM noted the Audit Committee's comments but did not propose to bring forward amendments in this regard. The Committee for OFM-DFM noted the distinction made between the Audit Committee agreeing the estimate and its being included in the Finance Minister's budget bill. However, the Committee for OFM-DFM noted that to date there had been no divergence between the agreed estimate and the figure included in the budget bill, and it further noted the Audit Committee was seeking to resolve the issue through a protocol with FP. The Ad Hoc Committee was content to agree Schedule 1, but draws the Assembly's attention to the concerns expressed by the Audit Committee that Schedule 1 may not provide the NIPSO with sufficient protection from the Executive controlling or directing its access to resources. The committee strongly recommends that the Committee for OFD. Sorry. Yes, of course.
I thank the member for giving way, Mr. Speaker. Just on this point, I think it is an important point, not just a political point, Mr. Speaker, but a constitutional point. If this Assembly is given the power to appoint and to provide for in terms of payment to and the terms and conditions of the NIPSO, then that power should not be restricted by the Department of Finance and Personnel in terms of the funding, because it's very important that the Office of Ombudsman is seen to be and is in fact independent and properly resourced. And there should be no constraints placed upon it by the political office of the Department of Health and Social Services. So the point I'm making, Mr. Speaker, to Lord Morrow is, I think, a very important and crucial part of the considerations of this Assembly, and that any safeguards that the member has talked about must be foolproof and must guarantee that independence, not just to the NIPSO, but also to this Assembly itself.
Well, I thank Mr. McGuinness for the points he makes. I've heard what he's said, and I think similar points were made during the journey of this bill through the Ad Hoc Committee. The committee strongly recommends that the Committee for OFM-DFM, as sponsor of the bill, take steps to address the concerns raised by the Audit Committee in respect of ensuring there is sufficient protection from the Executive controlling or directing the NIPSO's access to resources. The committee notes that the Audit Committee has urged the Minister for Finance and Personnel to agree a proposed memorandum of understanding between the Assembly and the Executive on the budget process, in which a protocol to resolve similar issues in respect of the budget of the Audit Office could be included. The committee also notes that to date no such protocol or MOU has been agreed. The Ad Hoc Committee recommends that an MOU acknowledging and safeguarding the NIPSO's financial independence should be agreed with DFP at the earliest opportunity. I look forward to hearing from the chairperson for the Committee for OFM-DFM on how the committee proposes to address the Ad Hoc Committee's recommendations and the concerns of the Audit Committee. Regarding the remaining technical amendments in this group proposed by the Committee for OFM-DFM, the Ad Hoc Committee was content to agree these amendments. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much, and I call Bronwyn McGahan.
I welcome the opportunity to speak in this bill. I've been involved from the very inception of this bill, and I'm now off OFM-DFM, but I still feel I have a role to play regarding this. The Chair would be aware that we are broadly happy with the provisions in the bill, and from the very inception of this bill we always opposed clauses 2, 3, 40 and 41, so it will come as no surprise that our party will be opposing some of the amendments in this bill. So we'll be opposing amendments 176, 130, 131. The change from the ombudsperson to the ombudsman. We live in a very progressive society, and my understanding is in America the term ombudsperson is used, and I don't believe that there's any confusion out there. Also as well, we will be opposing Amendment 5, the appointment of the ombudsman by the Queen. We don't believe that the Queen has any role to play in this. It should be the Assembly. It is a point of principle, and again, the chairperson of the committee would be well aware of our stance from the very beginning, so we have been on record regarding that matter. We're also opposed to Amendments 57, 58, 59. The disclosure contrary to public interest, we raised very serious concerns throughout the discussions at committee regarding national security and the involvement of the Secretary of State. When we were formulating our policy recommendations around this, the evidence showed that this was a policy area that was not used or utilised in any other region, so we didn't believe that there was a need. But however, it did go to the vote, and the committee then voted for this recommendation to be included, and then all the clauses that flowed from that. That's really all I have to say at the moment. I look forward to further consideration of this bill. Gura mé agat.
And I call Mr. Colm Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I can first of all give a broad welcome to this piece of legislation. I think it's very good and useful and important that a committee such as OFM DFM have done the work to bring an important bill like this to the House. I think it's a lesson, I suppose, for the rest of the committees that this can be done, and this can be done well and properly. I sat on the OFM DFM committee just when this bill was coming, beginning the process. It's been a long process. I haven't been on that committee in quite a while, but we're here now. I also sat on the ad hoc committee for my sins, and we had some good debates around some of the issues. I just want to focus on one of the issues in this section, which was in and around clause 37, which was the laying of reports. We had some concerns, and I know that the BMA had concerns, just around the impact of first of all, the general health practitioners being named on the schedule as one of some of the people who could be investigated by the Ombudsman. We were slightly concerned as to just the size of maybe a one or two person doctor surgery compared with a trust or a department of government, and just how all that fits together. We went through all the details of that, and I think whilst we still have some reservations, we're broadly content having discussed some of these issues with the Ombudsman himself. The issue around the laying of reports was one that did concern us. The potential for an individual doctor or doctor surgery to be named at the health committee, for example, was, I think, one which could be overreaching and could have consequences which could be very dire for that individual doctor or individual doctor surgery. Given how connected and close our community is, the reputational damage that could occur to somebody in and around that type of activity happening, I think would be very severe. So we did have these discussions in the committee, and we also spoke to the Ombudsman himself. Broadly content now, the Ombudsman said that he'd be happy to see those reports anonymised. How that actually plays out, we will keep a watchful eye on, but I think it would be important that those reports, if we ever got to the stage of laying one of these reports to the committee, that those reports would be anonymised to protect the the individual doctors concerned. And I think that maybe deals with a lot of the issues. There are some other issues as well, but that maybe deals with a lot of the issues in and around general practitioners. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Again, I call Mr. Trevor Lunn.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I was a member of the ad hoc committee, and I really want to speak about the section, the amendments which deal with the name of the ombudsman or ombudsperson. But can I just say before I start that I agree with Mr. Eastwood's comments about the laying of special reports, which I think may need some more attention, and also the issue of representation at an ombudsman's hearing or inquisitorial process, as he calls it. At the moment, the bill appears to allow the ombudsman to direct that a professional person before him may have to advise him, and he may need legal representation. The concern I have about that is that it may be too late. At that point, you know, he may already have compromised his position, and the evidence, the details of the Ombudsman's hearing are discoverable by perhaps a court if it has to go on to county court level. So I think we'll have to come back to that one. And the laying of special reports, particularly in terms of an individual GP, a single practice GP, is certainly cause for concern. And return to that. The question of the name, there's nothing sexist or whatever the word would be about the term ombudsman. As the chairman has already said, it goes back into modern history, and it goes back almost into prehistory. It's not an English word. It appears to be basically a Scandinavian word. It's in use all around the world, except Ms. McGagan's point that it's not in use in America now, but if you look around the near continent and anywhere else where they have ombudsmen, only in a very few circumstances do they call them ombudspersons. I think some commissioners in some countries are referred to as ombudspersons, but the general rule is historically based is ombudsman. Yeah?
I suppose from the outset I would have taken a view quite similar to himself until I did a wee bit of digging into this. And you're right to reference the historical, I suppose, connotations when it comes to ombudsman. It comes from the Old Norse, umbu, commission, matter, man. And I think that's something that we need to bear in mind. And when you started off speaking here today, a few times the member referred to he when he referred to ombudsman. And so it's not a sexist term. But I think if we're going to set a new office, I think we maybe could break away from this, which leads us to always say he or him, or, and it could be gender neutral if we go from its person.
Gormugget.
Yes, I accept the rebuke from Mr. Sorry, Chair, do you want to? I accept the comment, and I will frankly never manage to wholly convert myself to using they rather than he or she. That's the way we are, but that doesn't mean any offence. I'm sure he knows that. The formal use of that word goes back to 1809, when the Swedish Parliamentary Ombudsman was formed. But it goes back, actually, it's referred to in 1713 by the Swedish King Charles XII as Högsta Ombudsmannen. And if you want to trace it right back, you can almost find it in China, in the Qin dynasty of 221 BC, never mind in the Korean history of the Joseon dynasty, which is round about the same time. And I could actually take you to the Turkish use of the word, 634 to 644, but I mean, you could go on like this. But the fact is, down the centuries, this has been, it's common practice to use the term ombudsman. There are plenty of female persons in the position of ombudsman around the world right now who have no problem with being called the ombudsman. I think they quite value the phrase, actually. So that was the reason why I proposed this amendment, I think, at the committee, and I stand by it. It's a pity we can't agree about it, but there's no offence intended. And I might refer back to the Women in Politics report, which I think I instituted. I think my record in this is good enough that if I occasionally say he instead of she or they, you'll forgive me.
Okay, and I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt, the chairperson of the Committee for OFM-DFM.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much. And on behalf of the committee, could I begin by thanking the Lord Morrow and the Ad Hoc Committee for the valuable work it has done on the Public Service Ombudsperson Bill. Also thanks to the stakeholders who made submissions or gave evidence to the Ad Hoc Committee. And also thanks to the ministers and their officials, and indeed the Ombudsman's Office, who have again contributed to the committee's thinking during the committee stage. The Ad Hoc Committee recommended that the OFM-DFM Committee satisfy itself that there are adequate safeguards in place in relation to the exercise of the power to make a special report to this Assembly. This was in light of concerns raised that the naming of listed authorities in such reports could be construed as coercive. The OFM-DFM Committee considered this point, and indeed we took advice on it. And concluding that, we are content that it will be a matter for NIPSO, as a public authority, to exercise the power to make a special report in a manner which is compatible with the convention rights of the listed authority. Now, the power to make a report to the legislature is a key feature of other ombudsman legislation, and it underpins their authority. The Health Service Ombudsman for England has made reports to Parliament about individuals who are general healthcare providers. Mr. Speaker, I would just ask members to remind themselves it's a power which can only be exercised where NIPSO finds that the person aggrieved has sustained an injustice and that this has not or will not be remedied. And I think this place should be informed when that happens. So to address concerns raised by the Lord Morrow and by Mr. Eastwood, among others, it is a balance between the prospective reputational damage, for example, to a doctor or to a small GP surgery, against the fact that NIPSO has concluded that there has been an injustice which has not and will not be remedied. The Audit Committee highlighted to the Ad Hoc Committee that while the Audit Committee approves the budget estimate of the Controller and Auditor General and will approve the estimate of the NIPSO, this would not rule out the possibility that the Department for Finance and Personnel might take a different view. The OFM-DFM Committee is aware that the Committee for Finance and Personnel has been working to address this issue. The OFM-DFM Committee will explore it again, both with it and with the Audit Committee, to see if we can identify how best to progress and conclude a memorandum of understanding, which has been suggested as the best way of resolving the difficulties and tensions inherent in the involvement of the executive in the budget process for the bodies which scrutinise it. I think the Lord Morrow talked of sufficient protection from interference by the executive in setting the budget for a scrutiny body of that executive. I note the Ad Hoc Committee was content in relation to the provision in the bill which requires listed authorities to disclose to NIPSO relevant information which would otherwise be privileged, such as the relevant legal advice, and I refer here to Clause 32.2. I note some members continue to have concerns about that issue, but I can assure members the OFM-DFM Committee, like the Ad Hoc Committee, did take advice on this issue. The OFM-DFM Committee is satisfied that there are sufficient safeguards in the bill to avoid information being used to the detriment of the listed authority. The content of the advice cannot be disclosed in NIPSO reports, that's covered in Clause 38, or indeed used in court proceedings, as covered by Clause 47. So the normal privilege attaching to legal advice is not lost through the disclosure to the NIPSO. Mr. Speaker, I now turn to the amendments before us today. A comment first on the Ad Hoc Committee's amendments to change Ombudsperson to Ombudsman, namely Amendments 1, 76, 130 and 131. The OFM-DFM Committee, in light of the views expressed by the Ad Hoc Committee, commissioned more research on the etymology of the term Ombudsman. And in the end, the Committee was satisfied that the term is not gender-specific and there was cross-party support for the Ad Hoc Committee's amendments, although I note the contributions from Sinn Féin members this morning. The OFMDFM committee has proposed amendments 2, 3 and 77 on foot of a suggestion from the Office of Legislative Counsel, a recommendation that provision for the NIPSO to be a corporation sole would be preferable, and I'd like to thank the Office of Legislative Counsel for this and for a number of other very helpful comments. The effect of Amendment 77 is to provide the NIPSO will be a corporation sole, and that's in line with similar provision for the Comptroller and Auditor General and others. Amendment 3 removes the current provision in Clause 1.2, which would have established the Office of Ombudsperson. And Amendment 2 inserts in this Act the Ombudsperson at the end of Clause 1.1, as this interpretation provision would have been lost with the removal of Clause 1.2. I accept that if Amendments 1 and 3 are made, then Clause 1.1 will read, there is to be a Northern Ireland Public Services Ombudsman, whereas in this Act it reads Ombudsperson. However, this can be easily remedied at further consideration stage. Clause 2 declares that the NIPSO is independent and not subject to the direction of control of ministers or departments or of this Assembly. However, all public servants must be accountable, not least for the public monies that they receive. So the committee took the view that where possible, accountability should be to this Assembly, to the legislature, rather than to the executive. We felt accountability should be clearly stated in Clause 2.2, but having reflected on comments received during the committee stage, we agreed not all the provisions referenced in 2.2 amounted to powers of direction and control. Amendment 5 changes Clause 2.2 by both reducing the number of provisions referenced and making it clear what the nature of the provisions were, such as the setting of salary and other terms and conditions, the power of the Assembly to request the NIPSO's removal, which requires the support of 2/3 of all MLAs, and financial accountability. Clause 8 and 9 provides for own initiative investigations by the NIPSO. Clause 9 states NIPSO must publish the criteria for launching such an investigation. Amendment 6 makes it explicit that the NIPSO must also have regard to those criteria. Amendment 7 reflects two changes suggested by the Examiner of Statutory Rules, and I'd like to thank the Examiner for his report on the delegated powers which the Ad Hoc Committee shared with us. Clause 12 provides that the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, acting jointly, may by order amend the schedule of listed authorities in Schedule 3 that the NIPSO may investigate. The Examiner pointed out that such powers traditionally lie in departments, and Amendment 7 provides for it to lie with the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister. Amendments 9, 10 and 25 reflect similar change. Amendment 7 also makes provision for another suggestion that the power in Clause 12 to amend the schedule of listed authorities should be exercised with the concurrence of the Assembly Commission, reflecting the OFMDFM Committee's policy of aligning the NIPSO with the Assembly. However, the Committee wishes to consider this approach further and on that basis has decided not to move Amendment 7 at this stage, but to come back to this issue at further consideration stage. Amendment 25 introduces the same requirement in Clause 19, which empowers OFMDFM to update the schedule of tribunals in Schedule 4. Amendment 26 mirrors this approach by providing that the power in Clause 22 for the Assembly Commission by order to amend Schedule 5, matters which are excluded from investigation, should be exercised with the concurrence of OFMDFM. The committee, Mr. Speaker, has decided not to move Amendments 25 and 26 at this point. This will allow us time for further consideration, and we will revisit them at further consideration stage as necessary. Amendment 8 touches on Clause 12, which sets some criteria for the exercise of the power to add new bodies to the schedule of listed authorities, one of which is being publicly funded. Amendment 8 supplements the list of possible public funding mechanisms in 12.5 by inserting reference to expenses being defrayed out of monies appropriated by Act of Parliament. Amendments 14, 16 and 20 insert the words "of that body" to avoid any possible misreading of clauses 15.2c, 16(2)(b) and 17(2)(c). The effect of Amendments 28 and 36 is to provide for a standard wording across the clauses where the NIPSO is deciding whether to accept a complaint which has been submitted or referenced outside a time limit and where a complaints procedure hasn't been invoked and exhausted. Clauses 24 and 28 are amended to reflect the wording in Clause 26(4) so that the NIPSO may exercise discretion, quote, where there are special circumstances which make it proper to do so. Amendments 37 to 43 inclusive standardise some of the terminology in the bill, changing furnish and supply to provide and similar changes. Clause 37 deals with the NIPSO's laying reports before the Assembly. Amendment 55 clarifies that Clause 37(2) does not apply to a report on an own initiative investigation, such reports being required to be laid in the Assembly by Clause 37(3). Amendments 56 and 61 to Clauses 38 and 47 respectively insert references to the NIPSO's power to obtain information and documents under Clause 31. Amendment 57 requires that any non-disclosure notice served under Clause 41 must be in writing. Amendment 62, which applies to Clause 48, omits the words "or an officer of the Ombudsperson" as unnecessary in light of the Committee's proposed amendment to the power to delegation in Schedule 1 to the Bill. That is Amendment 79 to Schedule 1, which we shall come to later. Amendment 63 deals with Clause 49, making provision for the Office of the Northern Ireland Judicial Appointments Ombudsman to be held by the NIPSO. Amendment 63 provides for the current NIJO to cease to hold office when Clause 49 comes into operation. Amendments 64, 66 and 68 inclusive amend Clause 50, the interpretation. Amendment 64 appoints the reader to the definition of action taken by a listed authority in Clause 13. And Amendments 66 and 68 amend the provision dealing with ministers so that minister means a minister of a Northern Ireland department and a junior minister, and provides that Northern Ireland minister has the same meaning as in the Northern Ireland Act 1998. Amendment 70 inserts in effect a new clause to replace Clause 52, which the committee opposes standing part of the bill. The purpose is to make clearer provision for the exercise of delegated powers under the bill in line with the recommendations of the Examiner of Statutory Rules, including changing the mechanism for certain order-making powers from affirmative to draft affirmative, requiring an order to be laid in draft and approved by the Assembly before the order is made. Amendment 72 commences the power for the Department of Finance and Personnel to make arrangements for the transfer of staff 1 month after royal assent. Amendments 73 and 74 postpone the commencement dates for certain provisions to coincide with universities coming within the NIPSO's remit on the 1st of October 2016, and own initiative investigation powers, which will commence on the 1st of April 2018. Amendment 78 amends Schedule 1, subparagraph 5(4). It makes clear that someone who is currently the Judicial Appointments Ombudsman is not disqualified for being appointed as the NIPSO. And Schedule 2, paragraph 11, ensures the current Ombudsman would not be disqualified. It also ensures that appointment of the NIPSO as the Judicial Appointments Ombudsman is not prevented by paragraph 5(2), which prevents the NIPSO holding any other office. We now come to 17 identical technical amendments to Schedule 2, which deals with the transfer of assets, staff and other transitional issues. They are numbers 81 to 91, 93 to 95 and 98 to 100, so that references to appointed day becomes transfer day. And the transfer day, Mr. Speaker, is the 1st of April 2016. Amendment 92 replaces paragraph 8(2) of Schedule 2. It preserves the provisions of the current legislation dealing with the pensions of previous ombudsmen to avoid any detriment to them from the repeal of the current legislation. Amendments 96 and 97 amend Schedule 2, paragraph 10(1). The effect is to allow complaints to be made to the NIPSO in respect of the actions of listed authorities which predate the transfer day and which could have given rise to a complaint, where the complaint is made after the transfer day, the provisions of the NIPSO legislation will apply. Amendment 101 amends the schedule of listed authorities in Schedule 3 by replacing the individually named Northern Ireland departments with a generic A Northern Ireland department. Amendment 102 changes the reference to a grant-aided school to refer to the Board of Governors of a grant-aided school. Amendments 105 and 106 remove the entry for Health and Safety Agency that was accidentally included in Schedule 3 and relocate the entry for Health and Safety Executive. Amendment 109 updates the statutory provision under which the Planning Appeals Commission is constituted. This reflects changes that were made after the NIPSO Bill had been introduced. Amendment 110 removes paragraph 3 in Schedule 5. This provision excluded complaints between a healthcare body and a general healthcare provider about the arrangements between them. It is not needed because of the provision for complaints to come from a member of the public, that is, an individual or body other than a listed authority. Amendment 111 is simply restructuring paragraph 5.2 of Schedule 5 to make it easier for the reader. Amendment 112 inserts words in Schedule 6, which deals with the Northern Ireland Judicial Appointments Ombudsman, in order to repeal the provision of the Justice Northern Ireland Act 2002 that requires the Department of Justice to pay the expenses of the Judicial Appointments Ombudsman. The current Ombudsman and the Department have agreed a reallocation of budget to cover NIJO expenses. Amendments 113 and 14 deal with provisions of the Justice Northern Ireland Act that require NIJO to lay an annual report and a power to direct the NIJO to report on certain matters. The general approach taken was that the annual report should be laid in the Assembly rather than given to the Minister of Justice as at present, and that the power to direct the NIJO to report on a particular subject should be similarly given within the Assembly. However, the committee agreed to bring amendments 113 and 14 to give that power of direction to the Assembly Commission. And amendment 129, Mr. Speaker, includes in the table of repeals at Schedule 9 the Ombudsman and Commissioner for Complaints Amendment Act, Northern Ireland 2015, which the Assembly passed earlier this year to allow the acting Ombudsman's term of appointment to be extended and to provide time for the Assembly to deal with this NIPSO bill. It can safely be removed on commencement of the NIPSO Act. And that concludes my comments on this round, Mr. Speaker.
Can I call the Lord Morrow to mind?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In winding up on this first part of the debate, I would like to comment briefly in relation to some of the things that some of the members have been saying, and I will be very brief. I was not aware that there was any division in relation to whether the person should be called the Ombudsperson or Ombudsman. I think it was generally taken in the committee that this was the route to go, and I'm a wee bit surprised that in fact we now have it here on the floor of the Assembly today, where some seek to make an issue out of that particular point. However, we've heard what has been said. Also, in relation to the opposition to Her Majesty, we have not heard of that opposition before either, or at least I cannot recall it. In relation to Mr. Eastwood, what he said was, in relation to clause 37 and the laying of special reports, the potential naming of a GP by an NIPSO, yes, that was a matter that was discussed and stood quite a bit of debate and discussion, and it was something that the Assembly had, or the committee was perhaps exercised on, but we were able to proceed. Trevor Lunn said that he shares the SDLP's concern on special reports and also concern that there might be legal representation is at NIPSO's discretion, and that he is quite correct. He gave us some history lesson in relation to the name of the Ombudsman. He's quite correct when he says it is of Scandinavian origins, and I think he went on to remind us that it went back to the days of Charles XII, and I think Charles XII reigned somewhere between the late 1600s and the early 1700s. That is of my if I'm correct in that, but I have no doubt there will be some of our historians will stand up and challenge me in that if that's not correct. In respect, Mr. Speaker, of the technical amendments in this group proposed by the Committee for OFM-DFM, Mr. Nesbitt has provided the House with the Committee's intentions behind these amendments, and I do not propose to rehearse those again. In closing on this group of amendments, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to thank all the members who contributed in the debate so far. Thank you.
An amendment proposed in Clause 1, page 1, line 4, leave out Ombudsperson and insert Ombudsman. The question is that Amendment 1 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. Okay, clear the lobbies and the question will be put in 3 minutes. Members. And the question is that Amendment 1 be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I think the ayes might have it. Okay, do we have tellers?
Thank you.
Order, members. And tellers have been appointed as follows. Order, order, please. Tellers for the noes, Katrina Ryan and Jennifer McCann. And tellers for the ayes, David McElveen and Mike Nesbitt. The Assembly will divide, clear the lobbies. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Please secure the doors. Thank you. Order. Members resume their seats. Clerk, read the result.
80 members voted, 55 members voted aye, 25 members voted no. The amendment is made.
Amendment proposed to Clause 1, page 1, line 4, after Ombudsperson, insert in this Act the Ombudsperson. The question is that Amendment 2 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 3 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 3.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 1, page 1, line 5, leave out subsection 2, brackets 2. The question is that Amendment 3 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. We now come to the second group of amendments for debate. With Amendment 4, it will be convenient to debate the other amendments in this group, which deal with the powers and remit of the Ombudsperson. Members should note that Amendments 21 and 22 are mutually exclusive. Amendment 59 is consequential to Amendment 58. Amendment 108 is consequential to Amendment 24. Amendments 119 and 120 are mutually exclusive. Amendments 121 to 123, 125 and 128 are all consequential to Amendment 115. I call the Chairperson of the Committee for OFM-DFM, Mr Mike Nesbitt, to move Amendment 4 and to address the other amendments in this group. Mr Nesbitt.
Mr Speaker, thank you very much. I rise to move Amendment 4 and also address the other amendments in this group too. Amendment 4 makes it clear that the principal purpose of the NIPSO is to investigate alleged maladministration and avoid any suggestion of prejudging the result of that investigation. Amendment 11 qualifies the NIPSO's power of investigation of complaints of maladministration by making it explicit that the power exists only in relation to alleged maladministration through action taken in the exercise of administrative functions. While maladministration would obviously suggest that the power of investigation related to administrative actions, the committee was content to insert the explicit qualifying words. These can also be found in Amendments 12, 15, 18 and 21, covering all the bodies that can be investigated in Clauses 14 to 18. Amendments 13, 17 and 19 deal with the NIPSO's power to investigate complaints in the health and social care sector, complaints about the merits of a decision to the extent that it was taken in consequence of the exercise of professional or clinical judgment. Now, these amendments remove reference to clinical judgment as a separate category so that the powers of investigation in clauses 15 to 17 cover professional judgment, reflecting the approach taken in the Welsh Ombudsman legislation. Amendments 21 to 24 and Amendment 108 all touch on the NIPSO's proposed power of investigation in respect of universities. Amendments 22 and 23 are proposed by Mr. Alistair. I'll come to those in a moment. The effect of Amendments 24 and 108 are to relocate a provision clarifying that references to a university includes references to a constituent college, school or hall or other institution of a university from the notes at the end of Schedule 3 to the end of Clause 18. Amendment 21 makes it clear that the power of investigation relates to complaints from students enrolled in courses validated by the university. The theological colleges, which are members of Queen's University Institute of Theology, offer a range of courses, and not all their students are students at Queen's. Some are enrolled in courses validated by the universities of Chester and Cumbria, as well as others. The effect of Amendment 21 is to ensure that it is only those students at the theological colleges enrolled in courses validated by Queen's that can complain to the NIPSO. The universities of Chester and Cumbria, and indeed the Open University, provide their students with access to the Office of the Independent Adjudicator at the conclusion of the internal complaints procedure. and that while the OFMDFM committee's amendments would ensure it's only students enrolled in courses validated by the university who can complain to NIPSO, amendments 22 and 23 from Mr. Alistair would appear to take the policy in the opposite direction, so that anybody could complain about a university. Well, the committee considered these amendments together with Mr. Alistair's comments during the second stage debate and agreed not to support amendments 22 and 23. The fundamental question here is, who are the users or consumers of the publicly funded services, namely higher education, being provided by the universities? And clearly the answer is, it is the students. Amendment 53 clarifies that the power of publication of reports in the public interest in Clause 35 does not apply to reports of own initiative investigations. Publication of own initiative investigative reports is dealt with by Clause 36, where such reports must be published. Mr. Alistair's Amendment 54 to Clause 35 would, in effect, replace the committee's proposal for publication of reports where the NIPSO considers it in the public interest to do so, with a requirement for the NIPSO to publish all investigation reports on the NIPSO's website unless NIPSO believes it would not be in the public interest to publish. Personal details would be redacted upon the request of any person affected. I would remind members that at present the reports of the Ombudsman and the Commissioner for Complaints are not published, and the legislation prevents disclosure, save in very limited circumstances, one of which is the Ombudsman's report to the Assembly. Other Ombudsmen do publish case summaries on their websites and, in some cases, more detailed reports of their investigations. The committee considered that the confidential nature of the investigation and distribution of the report only to those immediately involved in the complaint tended to encourage open and frank engagement in the process, while the prospect of greater publicity may be a corresponding disincentive. In bringing forward its proposal in Clause 35 for publication of reports, where NIPSO considered it was in the public interest to do so, the committee had regard to the views of the current Ombudsman. The committee considers that this represents the best balance and agreed it would not support Amendment 54. Mr. Alistair's Amendment 58 would amend Clause 41. Clause 41 provides that OFMDFM, acting jointly, a Northern Ireland Minister or the Secretary of State may serve a non-disclosure notice on the NIPSO where the Minister is of the opinion that the disclosure of a document or information would be prejudicial to the safety of Northern Ireland or the United Kingdom or otherwise contrary to the public interest. 41.4 provides that the Secretary of State and the NIPSO must enter into a memorandum of understanding concerning the exercise of their functions in relation to this section. Amendment 58 would require that all those who can serve a non-disclosure notice must enter into such a memorandum with the NIPSO, and Amendment 59 provides for a new subsection 5 to allow for memoranda with a variety of ministers rather than a single memorandum with the Secretary of State. By way of background, members, the committee considered a request from the Secretary of State for a mechanism in the bill to help inform her decisions regarding the exercise of this power. The committee agreed, by a majority, that this mechanism would be a memorandum of understanding to be agreed between the Secretary of State and the NIPSO concerning the exercise of their functions in relation to Clause 41, and that the memorandum agreed would be laid in the Assembly. The underlying reason for this provision is that the Secretary of State would not normally be aware of what documents or information was being provided to the NIPSO, and therefore not in a position to consider a further disclosure by the NIPSO would be prejudicial to the safety of Northern Ireland or the United Kingdom, or otherwise contrary to the public interest. Northern Ireland ministers, on the other hand, would be in a position to be briefed about what information their departments or agencies were disclosing to NIPSO, and able to consider whether a non-disclosure notice was required. Therefore, the committee does not consider that Mr. Alistair's amendment is required and does not support it. Amendment 60 adds to the list of bodies with whom the NIPSO must consult and may cooperate with in Clause 42. These are the Local Government Auditor, the Controller and Auditor General, and RQIA, given its role in the regulation of health and social care bodies. The point of this provision is to avoid duplication of functions, investigations and costs, and to enable maximum cooperation. Amendment 79 inserts a new provision in clause in Schedule 1 of the bill, providing for delegation by the NIPSO to any member of staff. It also includes a new power to delegate to any other suitably qualified person where there are special circumstances which make it proper so to do. The Ombudsman had requested this power to manage circumstances where a conflict of interest might arise. Amendment 80 removes the current delegation provision at paragraph 14.5. Amendments 103, 104 and 107 bring the General Teaching Council within NIPSO's remit, and this, Mr Speaker, is at the Council's own request. It adds a newly created body, the Police Rehabilitation and Retraining Trust. This comes in at the request of the Department of Justice, and removes, at the request of the Department of Agriculture and Rural Development, the Rural Development Council, which is independent and is not core funded. We come now to Schedule 7, which deals with the NIPSO's role in relation to investigation of complaints about breaches of the Local Government Code of Conduct under Part 9 of the Local Government Act of 2014. Amendment 128 provides that the Ombudsperson is to be known as the Northern Ireland Local Government Commissioner for Standards when investigating under the Local Government Act 2014. This was a change requested by the current Ombudsman, and the Minister was content. As a result, we no longer need a number of provisions inserting Ombudsperson at various places in the 2014 Act. Most notably, Amendment 115 removes a long list of such insertions, as do Amendments 121, 122, 123 and 125. Amendment 116 was requested by the current Ombudsman following agreement with the Minister for the Environment. It inserts a new section, 56A, into the 2014 Local Government Act to make explicit provision that the Commission may, following a Code of Conduct investigation, hold an adjudication hearing, and where he or she does so, such a hearing must be in public. Amendment 127 provides that the NIPSO Bill provisions relating to legal representation, witness expenses, the power to compel witnesses and require the production of documents, as well as the provisions relating to obstruction and contempt, that these provisions apply in relation to adjudication hearing as they apply in relation to a NIPSO investigation. Amendment 118, also requested by the Ombudsman, will allow the Commissioner to publish reports of investigations under the Local Government Act on his or her website. Amendment 117 provides that where the Commissioner censures someone, notice must be given to the Clerk of the Council concerned. The Committee has laid two amendments that touch on the opening paragraph of the new Section 63 to be inserted in the 2014 Act on page 40 of the Bill. The Committee prefers the late revised form of Amendment 120, and accordingly I will not be moving the earlier version in Amendment 119. Amendment 120 provides for the applicable powers in the 2015 Act to be read as if they applied, as if references to the Ombudsperson were references to the Commissioner. And Mr Speaker, could I also mention at this stage that the Committee has agreed not to move Amendments 113 and 114 to allow further time for consideration of allocating functions to the Assembly Commission. Amendment 124 provides for the Commissioner to exercise the NIPSO's consultation and cooperation powers in relation to the Local Government Auditor and the Controller and Auditor General in light of their remit in relation to the works of councils. And Amendment 126 omits a reference to the expenses of the NIPSO in discharging this local government role. This is adequately set out in the Local Government Act of 2014. And Mr Speaker, that concludes my remarks on this midsection of our debate.
Gaoin, I call the Lord Morrow.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. With regard to the amendments 4, 11 to 13, 15 and 17 to 19 proposed by the Committee for OFF DFM, the Ad Hoc Committee noted that these amendments provide qualifications of the power of investigation of the NIPSO, in that the powers would relate to alleged maladministration through action taken in the exercise of administrative functions and would exclude any judicial or quasi-judicial functions. The committee also noted the clarification provided with respect to the distinction between clinical and professional judgment. The committee was content with these amendments. In respect of Clause 18, the committee considered this new power for the NIPSA to investigate maladministration as it relates to universities superseding the existing power of the Board of Visitors of a university to investigate complaints by students. The committee noted the views of the universities which felt that the existing Board of Visitors system offered a more flexible remedy for students. Conversely, student representatives felt that the Board of Visitors should be excluded from considering any complaints in relation to student matters. During its deliberations, the committee sought clarification from the Committee for OFM-DFM on the jurisdiction of the NIPSA in respect of constituent and theological colleges. The committee noted Amendment 21 clarifies the situation for students of theological colleges and ensures that only those students enrolled in courses validated by universities here can complain to the NIPSA. The committee noted that Amendment 24 provides clarity in respect of constituent colleges and that Amendment 108 moves the provisions in respect of Amendment 24 from Schedule 3 to Clause 18. The ad hoc committee was content with these amendments proposed by the Committee for OFM-DFM, but noted the concerns of some members in relation to the inclusion of universities within the NIPSO's remit. With regard to Mr. Alistair's amendments in respect of Clause 18, that is Amendments 22 and 23, the ad hoc committee did not consider these prior to formal clause-by-clause scrutiny and therefore have no view. The committee did, however, take note of Mr. Alistair's comments on these provisions at the second stage debate on this bill and indeed raised these issues with the Northern Ireland Ombudsman when he gave evidence to the committee in May. It may be helpful to outline the Ombudsman's response. With regard to the fact that the NIPSA will not have power to investigate complaints made by university staff, the Ombudsman highlighted that in developing its policy proposals, the Committee for OFM-DFM decided that it is no longer defensible that only people in the public sector would have access to the NIPSO in relation to employment issues, and that there are other suitable mechanisms such as the Equality Commission, industrial tribunals and so forth for resolution of such complaints. The Ombudsman stated that, and I quote, it would not be consistent to abolish employment jurisdiction in the public service and at the same time to be bringing university employment issues into the jurisdiction of the Ombudsman. We are putting the employment issues of public servants and civil servants on the same footing as everybody else now across Northern Ireland. Moving to Mr. Alistair's proposed amendment to Clause 35, that is Amendment 53 again, the committee did not have sight of this amendment prior to formal clause-by-clause scrutiny and therefore does not have a view. During its deliberation in Clause 35, the committee noted that a number of stakeholders, in their response to the call for evidence, recommended that reports by the NIPSA should be published. However, concerns were expressed by representatives of the medical profession about the publication of reports on investigations when issues of clinical judgment are involved, and they recommended that reports on exercise of clinical judgment should not be published. The committee noted that the intention of the bill as drafted is to leave it to the NIPSO's discretion to determine whether a report raises an issue of sufficient public interest to warrant publication. And the committee heard from the Ombudsman that publication of all reports would have resource implications and that moving to a position where all reports should be put into the public domain would be something which the Ombudsman would envisage developing over time as capacity and expertise within the Ombudsman's office is built up. The committee was content to agree Amendment 54, proposed by the Committee for OFM-DFM, to clarify the situation on publication of reports in the public interest. In respect of Mr Alistair's proposed amendments to Clause 41, that is Amendments 58 and 59, again the committee did not have sight of the amendment prior to formal clause-by-clause scrutiny and therefore does not have a view. In its consideration of Clause 41, which relates to disclosure contrary to public interest, the committee noted that there is similar provision in legislation for the Scottish and Welsh Ombudsmen for the Parliamentary Ombudsman. The committee noted comments from the Ombudsman that a memorandum of understanding with the Secretary of State is on narrow grounds to cover issues of national security. The Secretary of State is in a different position as regards NIPSO from executive ministers whose actions will be overseen by NIPSO. There would be a substantial risk of the perception that the NIPSO was not independent from the executive if it were to enter into an MOU with the head of the department he has power to investigate. This proposal would undermine the independence of the NIPSO. I consider that to extend an MOU to executive ministers would raise in the public's mind suspicion and a perception of lack of independence, and I do not consider it necessary or desirable to extend this." End of quote. With regard to this group of amendments, the Ad Hoc Committee had considered Amendments 60, 115, 119, 126 and 128 prior to formal clause-by-clause scrutiny. The committee noted that these amendments were largely technical in nature, providing clarity on which provisions in the bill will have effect in relation to the Local Government Act and removing unnecessary drafting. The committee was content to agree these amendments. With regard to Amendment 79 proposed by the Committee for OFM DFM Schedule 1 to Schedule 1, the committee noted correspondence from the Northern Ireland Ombudsman seeking this amendment in order to provide for delegation to any other person to firstly allow for delegation of an investigation to another ombudsman should a conflict arise, and secondly to provide for an external review process. As the amendment was not available for the committee's consideration prior to the formal clause-by-clause scrutiny, the committee did not take a view. Regarding Amendment 103, 104 and 107 to the listed authorities in Schedule 3, the committee noted various requests made to the Committee for OFM DFM for amendment to Schedule 3, namely from the General Teaching Council and from the Department of Justice to add the Police Rehabilitation and Retraining Trust to the listed authorities under the remit of the NIPSO. The committee also noted that the Department of Agriculture and Rural Development sought to remove the removal of the Rural Development Council from the listed authorities. The Committee for OFM DFM amendments to give effect to these changes to Schedule 3 were not available for that Hog Committee's formal clause-by-clause consideration, and the committee did not take a view. The committee did not have sight of the remaining amendments in this group prior to the formal clause-by-clause scrutiny and therefore did not take a view. Thank you, Mr Speaker.
Could I just raise to make a number of points in this particular group? Could I first of all thank all of the officials who have been very, very supportive of the committee in our fairly lengthy and protracted deliberations on this particular bill, including the Bills Office, officials who have been very, very helpful and supportive of all of the members. My colleague Bronwyn McGahan, as earlier this morning, really made it clear that we are very much in support of this particular bill, albeit that we are opposed to a small number of the provisions around that, and particularly the relationship that the bill wants to have in terms of the appointment of the ombudsperson by Her Majesty, as it's called in the bill, and the issues around disclosure in relation to Official Secrets Act and public interest matters, equally in relation to the involvement of the Secretary of State, the proposed involvement. So whilst we are opposed to those matters, and we made that very clear consistently, and I know that Lord Morrow has said he had never heard those issues, those concerns. That may well have been at the Ad Hoc Committee. I don't know, I'm not a member of that, but certainly at the Principal Committee, OFM, DFM, it has been routinely and consistently raised at every occasion when the matter arose in deliberation. I think the chairperson of the committee would acknowledge that. But obviously, you know, we didn't get other support for that, and that's a matter, again, of record. But we are very much in support of the intent of the bill itself. In fact, as it has been suggested and made very clear, this bill is about merging both the Office of the Independent Commissioner for Complaints with the Ombudsman's Office, as it is currently, into the new NIPSO. And we believe that the new provisions in their totality will actually enhance the protections of members of the public who may well fall foul of any deficits there that may well be within the public sector in terms of public service delivery. And again, put on the record that, as far as we be concerned, we all know that the very vast majority of public servants and those who are discharged with responsibility to dispense with public services are absolutely 100% professional, have their own integrity, personal and professional, and deliver a perfect, a very, very good service. But there are, of course, always cracks in the various systems, and this particular bill here is designed to try to make sure that people who fall foul of any of those deficits will have the maximum protection at their disposal. So we have considered all of the matters long and hard. Some of the decisions that the committee have reached, mostly by way of consensus, have been on the basis of the balance of the evidence presented to us, and I think the chairperson very well highlighted a number of those today in his remarks, particularly within this particular group. I would just like to make a couple of points. I mean, there are a number of amendments in this group that we will be opposing. There will be 22 and 23. Moved by Mr. Jim Allister, and these really, as it has already been suggested, these relate to actually whether or not this remit would be exclusively at the disposal of students, or will it bring in others. We are satisfied that it is important to make sure that they reiterate the point that this is about the delivery of public services and the discretion at the discretion of the recipient of the public services, where they believe that there is a failure, whereas staff and others have the other recourses to redress if they feel that they have the need for such. So on that basis, we're opposed to Amendments 22 and 23. We're also opposed to Amendment 54, and that is on the basis that the Ombudsman, the Ombudsperson, NIPSO, will have all of the latitude necessary to make the judgment calls. Again, on balance, we have been advised that, and I think the Chair already made this point, that on balance, where reports are generally going to be withheld to the people who are directly involved, that has led to better outcomes for the complainants. So that's on balance, then we took that decision. On Amendments 58 and 59, we're opposed to both those amendments because both those relate to Clause 41, of which we, and we've already made this clear, we're opposed to Clause 41, so we will be opposing Amendments 58 and 59 as well. Okay, so on that basis, and also 54, sorry, Mr. Speaker. Okay, so I mean, I'll conclude on that remark this morning. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Alvin McGuinness.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I rise to refer to clauses 32 and also clause 30. Mr. Speaker, in relation to clause 32.1 and 32.2 of the bill, these deal with legal privilege, and some issues were raised in relation to legal privilege, and I think it's worth addressing those issues because it's been suggested in particular by the BMA that these provisions would introduce a new power for the NIPSO to override legal professional privilege. Now, in fact, and indeed in law, that is not correct, because the Ombudsman's current powers in relation to investigations conducted as Assembly Ombudsman under the Ombudsman Northern Ireland Order 1996 permit the Ombudsman access to legal advice held by Northern Ireland civil service departments and indeed their statutory agencies. And his practice has been to request access to legal advice infrequently, Mr. Speaker, and only where it's relevant to an investigation. The legal advice is, however, not shared with the complainant or any other person and is held in confidence by the Ombudsman and his staff. Now, I would certainly be very concerned if, in fact, this threatened legal privilege. I think it's important that we preserve legal privilege. But given the legal advice which the ad hoc committee received in relation to this matter, and considering what the Ombudsman has said in relation to this aspect of the bill, that is, in relation to clauses, clause 32.1 and 32.2, given that, I am reassured, Mr. Speaker, that in fact the legal professional privilege is not threatened in a real sense by clause 32, and I think those who have raised and properly raised criticisms in relation to this clause should themselves be reassured that it doesn't stray into that area, and that legal privilege is in fact safeguarded in these circumstances. So I wanted to raise that, Mr. Speaker, because I know it was a matter that concerned a number of people, not just the BMA, but it also concerned the Bar Council, it also concerned the Law Society and some others involved in the legal profession. But I think that this House can be assured that, in fact, legal professional privilege is still protected, and that this bill continues with that protection. Yes.
I very much thank the member for giving way, Mr. Speaker. Just to thank him, because I very much value his assurance that he accepts that legal privilege is being protected, not least given his own legal background. I think, Mr. Speaker, an earlier contributor to the debate felt that perhaps that legal advice might be disclosed in the county courts, and just to assure members, that is not the case. The only person who will have access to privileged legal information will be the Ombudsman, which will allow him or her to come to the right decision, but they will not further disclose. Under any circumstances, they will not further disclose that legal privilege, so that barrier is protected, as Mr. McGuinness has pointed out.
And I'm grateful to Mr. Nesbitt, his contribution in relation to this matter. And I do think it is important to reassure the public generally in relation to this, and legal practitioners in particular in relation to this, Mr. Speaker. There is effectively a firewall between what the, in terms of the legal advice which the Ombudsman receives, that firewall does not permit that legal advice or that information to go further than his own office, and I think that's important to remember. There is another issue which arises, Mr. Speaker, and that relates to clause 37B of the bill, and that relates to legal representation. Now, what clause 37B does, it gives the NIPSO a discretion to determine whether a person can be legally or otherwise represented. 7 says, in particular, the Ombudsman may A, make such inquiries as are appropriate, and B, determine whether any person may be represented in the investigation by counsel, solicitor or otherwise. And again, this is a matter that was raised by the BMA. They said that the opportunity which currently exists in Article 12 of the Commissioner for Complaints Northern Ireland Order 1996 for the body complained against to request a formal hearing and to be legally represented. Under the bill, they say, this provision will be removed, but there is a right to legal representation at the Ombudsman's discretion. And that is correct, that there is now a discretion, if this clause is accepted, there is now a discretion with the Ombudsman to permit, in certain circumstances, legal representation. I am not saying definitively at this point, Mr. Speaker, that I disagree with the removal of the automatic right of representation and that the discretion is wrong. What I do raise is the question whether or not this House should consider restoring the current allowing the current situation to remain. In other words, that there would be an automatic right to legal representation in certain circumstances, as opposed to a discretion on the part of the Ombudsman. I raise the issue, Mr. Speaker, because I think the House should think and carefully about this and reflect upon it. And it may well be that at a further consideration stage, this matter could be re-examined by way of further amendment. Technically, whether that's possible or not, it may prove difficult. But nonetheless, I think it's a matter that the House should be sensitive to and should give special consideration to, because there is a sense that if there isn't legal representation, automatic legal representation, then the person or body that's being investigated would be at a disadvantage. Yes.
I thank the member for giving way, and I'm speaking not as chairman of the committee on this occasion, because I don't think it's something we have looked at in these terms. But just as you were saying, we should consider these matters, and I very much agree we should consider them. Perhaps we should look at a recent example, which is the Historical Institutional Abuse Inquiry, where the chair, Sir Anthony Hart, I think, makes the call as to whether individuals or groups should have access to publicly funded legal representation. And it may be an idea to examine the efficacy of how that regime has worked heretofore in the HIA inquiry.
And the member makes a very good point, Mr. Speaker, and it may well be that this House prefers the new arrangement, or what is posited as a new arrangement in terms of the Ombudsman having that discretion. But I do raise those points, Mr. Speaker. I think it is important that where stakeholders go to the extent to make to give evidence to committee, to the ad hoc committee in this instance, make representations to individual members of committee and individual political parties in this House. I think it's important at least that we ventilate those issues so that those issues are not forgotten about when we consider aspects of this bill or indeed any other legislation. And perhaps if I could just conclude by saying, in relation to Clause 11B2 of the bill, and that's where, in fact, the Ombudsman, in terms of his investigation, where it appears the Ombudsman to be desirable to bring about a settlement, including by recommending that action be taken by the person aggrieved or listed authority, or two, that the listed authority make a payment to the person aggrieved. It's been suggested there, Mr. Speaker, that this is effectively a compensatory payment which the Ombudsman is imposing upon the public body or individual complained about. That is an incorrect interpretation of the previous legislation and what is proposed in this bill, because he is making a recommendation. The whole approach of the Ombudsman is to try and reach a settlement, and contained within that settlement is a recommendation. It is that the person complained about, or the body complained about, does not have to accept that recommendation, although it has to be said in many instances that recommendation is accepted. But it is not, in fact, a compensatory payment. And I think that should be made clear, because that has been a view expressed to the ad hoc committee and to this House, and I think it's an incorrect view. Yes, in circumstances where the recommendation is rejected, in those circumstances the complainant can go to the county court in order to have that court determine what payment can in fact be made and effectively imposed upon the person complained about or the body complained about. But that's an entirely different situation. Just want to clarify that point, Mr. Speaker, because I think it's important that the legal and factual situation be properly expressed within this House, so that people outside are properly informed of the situation. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you very much. I call Mr. Jim Allister.
Thank you. I have three groups of amendments on this bill. I'm going to speak primarily to Amendment 54 initially, because I think it is a very important issue. Touching upon the publication and the outcome of complaints, because the presumption at the moment, contrary to the situation which prevails in some other jurisdictions, is that a complaint, when investigated by the Ombudsman, that the Ombudsman's report remains effectively secret. It is not publicised. And indeed, those who bring complaints receive what to them, being unfamiliar with the territory, appears quite an intimidatory letter when they get the report, warning them that they must not disclose the content of the report. I must say, I don't think that's in the public interest. It came to my attention particularly in the aftermath of the PMS saga, when a complainant made a very legitimate complaint and had his complaint upheld about how the department had handled matters touching upon the PMS. And yet he got a report which was in his favour, was a severe warning not to publicise the report. Why? Because of the statutory presumption against publication. Was that in the public interest? I think not. I think that there were issues there which require and could benefit from public knowledge and ventilation. And then, when I had an occasion of a constituent who'd made, again, a very serious and proper complaint against the Northern Health Trust and had the findings upheld, I thought I would ask the department in a question in this House what action they take on foot of reports from the Ombudsman on health issues. And I tabled that question, and it was answered on the 17th of October 2013. And the question was to ask the Minister of Health, Social Services and Public Safety, what procedures and follow-up exist to ensure that recommendations from the Ombudsman, when upholding a complaint in respect of the standard of care in a health service facility or administration failures therein, are adequately acted upon, and whether his department monitors such matters. I'll pause there to suggest that I would have thought most members of the public would expect that if there is a finding adverse in respect of how something has been done in the health service, that the Minister of Health and the Department of Health would be in a position to monitor how matters have improved and to act upon and to ensure that the Trust acts upon the matters where they were found wanting. But the amazing answer which came from the Minister was, all investigations by the Ombudsman are conducted in private. The Ombudsman has no general powers to share information publicly. My department, therefore, does not receive copies of the Ombudsman's investigation reports. These are strictly confidential and are only shared by the Ombudsman with those individuals stroke organisations concerned. So here we have a situation under the current regime which this bill seeks to preserve, that a complaint, for example, as in this case to the Northern Trust, which finds failures which can be learnt from by others, that that report isn't even within the knowledge of the department. I think that is appalling. Yes?
Hey, but surely he recognises that under our proposals, the NIPSO will have the right and the ability to publish when he believes it's in the public interest.
I understand that. But at the moment, there's been no recourse to publication in the public interest. And in other jurisdictions, the starting point, this is about the presumption, about the starting point. What is the starting point? Surely the starting point should be a presumption in favour of publication. And that's what my amendment says, that in the circumstances where it's not in the public interest to publicise, then you don't. But the presumption should be in favour of publication, because I find it astounding in the examples I've given that there has been no publication of those reports and no assurance under this legislation that there would be publication. Where's the public interest in concealing from the Department of Health findings against some of its arm's length bodies? And yet that is what has been happening and could continue to happen unless we take the initiative and reverse the onus, and unless we make the presumption in favour of publication and cause non-publication to be demonstrated to be in the public interest. So that is why Amendment 54 is couched as it is, to reverse that presumption and to cause all reports to be publicised on the website with personal details redacted, where that is the request of the individual or the organisation or the staff within the organisation, unless the Ombudsman thinks it wouldn't be in the public interest to publicise the report at all. And I do ask the question, what is there to lose with that reproach? It seems to me that is the common sense, sensible approach to end the nonsense situation that affected departments may not even know about reports that they should be monitoring the implementation of steps which are taken in foot of those reports, and presently they're kept in the dark. That is in no one's interest. And that is the logic and the that lies behind Amendment 54. And I trust, I've heard some people comment upon it adversely, I trust that they would reconsider, take on board those points. And I was very surprised to hear that the Ombudsman raised an objection on resource implications. What the amendment calls for is the report to be put on the website. Where are the resource implications on putting a report on the Ombudsman's website so that anyone can view it and learn from it and avoid the mistakes that were made before. There can't be serious resource implications, yes.
I thank the member for giving way, and he has taken good time to make a point that he feels strongly about, and the chair has of the OFM-DFM committee has responded to make clear that the power to publish would be provided for in the bill on the decision of the Ombudsman. One particular concern that was raised with the committee was that the approach being proposed by Mr. Alistair may in some way impede open and frank engagement in the process, while the prospect of greater public guaranteed publicity could be a corresponding disincentive in relation to that. Would he have any view in relation to those concerns that were raised?
Well, it's precisely because of there being some validity attaching to those concerns that the amendment is worded as it is, with the proviso that personal details are redacted upon the request of the person affected. So yes, somebody making a complaint but not wanting to be named across the media as the complainant or their details generally publicised is protected in this amendment to, upon request, have their details redacted so that no one need know or would know who they are. And likewise with whoever the person within the establishment that's being complained against, whoever the individual is, likewise could request. So I think the concern about disincentive is removed by the protection that's built into the amendment of allowing personal details to be redacted. And the further safety net is the giving to the Ombudsperson the right to prevent publication if he thinks that's in the public interest. So really, this amendment, to me, turns the matter into the right direction by making the presumption, the starting point being publication subject to redaction and the public interest recourse only used to prevent publication, rather than saying no publication unless public interest steps in the eyes of the Ombudsman and no one else, and decides in public interest there can be a publication. So, you know, in what's supposed to be open, transparent society, where government and agencies are supposed to be subject to scrutiny, I do have to say that logically and properly the onus and the starting point should be and the presumption of publication, rather than a starting point of a presumption of concealment. And that's what this legislation presently makes as its starting point, concealment of the outcome of reports. And I don't think that's in the public interest. So for the reasons I've given, I recommend that amendment to the House. In relation to the other amendments, the point on amendments 22 and 23 is very simple, that within the educational system, there are provisions for staff, etc., who feel wronged in respect of how they've been treated. But it's a situation of in-house supervision where the visitors are appointed by the university, and it really does lack the transparency of a proper public scrutiny. And therefore, that's why I thought it was appropriate that within, if we're bringing the universities into the ambit of this bill, we should bring all of their administration within the ambit of this bill, not just how they deal with students, but how they also deal with staff, because there have been a number of pretty dissatisfied outcomes in respect of staff and visitor arrangements. So I think there's nothing to lose in that. On Amendments 58 and 59, it's simply making the point that if local ministers are to have the power under Clause 41 to serve a notice preventing a disclosure of documents prejudiced to the safety of Northern Ireland, and therefore contrary to the public interest, that it strikes me as rather incongruous that if the Secretary of State is to exercise that function, she exercises it within the ambit of a memorandum of understanding with the Ombudsman, but if the local minister is to exercise that function of a preventing disclosure of documentation, he can do it at large with no restraint of any memorandum of understanding, and therefore that's the territory that I wanted to balance up and to say, well, if there's a memorandum of understanding required for one, why not the other? Because within both, there may need to be the protections that a memorandum of understanding would provide in order to protect against a unwarranted recourse to preventing disclosure by adopting the language that's easy to adopt. Oh, this would be prejudicial to the interests or the safety of Northern Ireland. And, you know, I think there does have to be, just as you'd expect it for the Secretary of State, so I would expect it for any of the ministers given that power, the same memorandum of understanding or a parallel one to cover them. So that's the logic and the reason for those two amendments. Thank you.
Of the committee for OFM DFM.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I welcome the opportunity to wind on this group of amendments. I thank all members who have contributed to the debate today. I think it has been constructive engagement with the amendments throughout. I think the chairperson for the OFM DFM committee set out the committee position in relation to the amendments in effective detail. And I won't go through that again. I think Lord Morrow, as chairperson of the ad hoc committee, did the same, particularly responding to clarity that had been sought in relation to provisions relating to universities and theological colleges, expressing reassurance in relation to those. And then we heard from a number of members also in relation to the amendments. Mr. Maskey commented and delivered support for the bill on behalf of Sinn Féin, notwithstanding objections that had been presented consistently at committee stage in relation to the appointment process and provisions for arrangements with the Secretary of State. He stated that he thought it was a positive bringing together of the Commissioner for Complaints and the Ombudsman, and that it and he hoped that it would enhance protection for the public in relation to the delivery of public services, but also, I think, helpfully noted that, of course, the majority of public servants in our community seek to deliver an effective service with the utmost integrity at all times. He noted, as the committee has, that Sinn Féin would be opposing Amendments 22, 23, 54, 58 and 59. Mr. McGuinness, on behalf of the SDLP, raised important points in relation to Clause 32.1.2 in terms of concerns that had been raised by stakeholders such as BMA, Bar Council and the Law Society with regards to legal privilege. I think he has outlined how those concerns have been addressed capably. And they are issues that we have also heard from the chairperson on in order to reassure those bodies that indeed legal professional privilege is not altered by the bill. He also addressed Clause 37B and asked for some reflection in relation to the introduction of discretion for the Ombudsman to permit legal representation. And the chairperson of the OFM-DFM committee gave the helpful example of the arrangements that are in place for the historical abuse inquiry chair that may be worth examining. Mr. Alistair then spoke to the amendments that he is proposing today. The chairperson for the OFM-DFM committee and myself has responded to those amendments that have been raised. I think in terms of Amendment 54, the chairperson has made it of the OFM-DFM committee, and the committee are content that Clause 34.2d makes provision for report to be provided to any person that the Ombudsman considers appropriate, and indeed does create the power for the Ombudsman to publish a report when in the public interest. The committee did not consider that the case had been made for reversing that arrangement, and we certainly would not agree with Mr. Alistair that the provisions proposed are in any way akin to concealment. This is very much indeed about creating a system where members of the public feel at ease and have a clear pathway to raising concerns that they have in relation to the delivery of public services with the Ombudsman's office, and indeed, of course, to have provision made that where the issue or the findings of any investigation are in the public interest, that that is made fully publicly available, and that any other persons the Ombudsman considers appropriate are notified about those findings. The committee also did not think the case had been made for Amendments 22, 23, 58 and 59, and as has been mentioned, will be opposing those amendments at this stage. In closing, Mr. Speaker, I'd like to add my thanks also to the officials who have worked tirelessly in relation to this group of amendments, the Ombudsman, who has engaged effectively, and all stakeholders, and the ad hoc committee and members of this House that have contributed to this stage of the bill. Thank you.
And the amendment proposed to Clause 1, page 1, line 7, after investigate, insert alleged. The question is that Amendment 4 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 1, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 5 has already been debated. I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 5.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 2, page 2, line 1, leave out subsection, brackets 2, and insert words as printed in the Marshall list. The question is that Amendment 5 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. So Clause 2 as amended. The question is that Clause 2 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 3. The question is that Clause 3 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clauses 4 to 8, and I propose by leave of the Assembly to group these clauses for the question on stand part. The question is that clauses 4 to 8 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 6 has already been debated, and I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 6.
Move, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to Clause 9, page 4, line 18, after publish, insert the words as printed on the Marshall list. And the question is that Amendment 6 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 9 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clauses 10 or 11, and I propose by leave of the Assembly to group these clauses for the question on stand part. The question is that clauses 10 and 11 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 7 has already been debated. I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally.
Not moved, Mr. Speaker.
Yeah, not moved. And Amendment 8 has already been debated, and I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 8.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 12, page 5, line 27, at end, insert the words as printed on the Mercer list. And the question is that amendment 8 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 9 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 9.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 12, page 5, line 31, leave out and insert words as printed on the Mercer list. The question is that Amendment 9 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 10 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 10.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 12, page 5, line 33, leave out and insert the words as printed on the Mercer list. The question is that Amendment 10 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Yeah. The question is that clause 12 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clause 13. The question is that clause 13 stand part of the bill. And all those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 11 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 11.
Move, Mr Speaker.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 14, page 6, line 8, after taken, insert words as printed on the Mercer list. And the question is that Amendment 11 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 14 is amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 12 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 12.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 15, page 6, line 18. After taken, insert the words as printed on the Mercer list. And the question is that Amendment 12 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 13 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 13.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 15, page 6, line 20. Leave out paragraphs, bracket B. The question is that Amendment 13 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 14 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 14.
Moved.
Thank you. You're getting good at that. Amendment proposed to clause 15, page 6, line 22. Insert the words as printed on the Mercer list. The question is that Amendment 14 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Those in contrary, no. And the ayes have it. The question is that clause 15 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. I'm glad the Ulster Scots vote has been heard there. So, Amendment 15 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 15.
Moved.
That's very moving. Amendment proposed to clause 16, page 6, line 29, insert the words as printed on the Mercer list. The question is that Amendment 15 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 16 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to formally move Amendment 16.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 16, page 6, line 31. Insert the words as printed on the Mercer list. The question is that Amendment 16 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 17 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 17.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 16, page 6, line 32, leave out clinical and insert professional. The question is that Amendment 17 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 16 is amended and part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. And Amendment 18 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 18.
Moved.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to clause 17, page 7, line 10. Insert words as printed on the Mercer list. The question is that Amendment 18 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
contrary, no. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 19 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 19.
Move.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to Clause 17, page 7, line 13. Leave out paragraph brackets B. The question is that Amendment 19 be made, and all those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. Amendment 20 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 20.
Moved, Mr.
Thank you. And amendment proposed to Clause 17, page 7, line 15. Insert the words as printed on the Marshall list. The question is that Amendment 20 be made, and all those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The question that clause is that Clause 17 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 21 has already been debated and is mutually exclusive with Amendment 22. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 21.
Move.
Thank you. Amendment proposed to Clause 18, page 7, line 26, leave out subsection brackets 2 and insert the words as printed on the Marshall list. The question is that Amendment 21 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. I will not call to Amendment 22 as it is mutually exclusive with Amendment 21, which has been made. Amendment 22, sorry, excuse me. Amendment 23 has already been debated, and I call Mr. Alistair to move formally Amendment 23. Not moved. Amendment 24 has already been debated, and I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 24. Amendment proposed, I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally Amendment, I beg your pardon, 24.
Thought we were getting good at this. Moved, Mr. Speaker.
Well, you're getting good at it. I'm getting worse. So, amendment proposed to Clause 18, page 7, line 37. Insert the words as printed on the Marshall list. The question is that Amendment 24 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 18, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes just about had it. And I'm advised that. Yeah, okay. So is it moved or not? Okay. Amendment 25 has already been debated. I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 25.
Not moved.
Not moved. Thank you. So the question is that Clause 19 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clauses 20 or 21, and the question is that clauses 20 and 21 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 26 has already been debated, and I call Mr. Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 26.
Not moved, Mr. Speaker.
Not moved.
Sorry, 2 seconds, just to check. I think that's the only amendment.
Just give us one moment here to be checked. Okay, we're just checking that there was no prior amendment, but the question is that Clause 22 stand part of the bill, so no amendment. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. And the ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 23. The question is that Clause 23 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Can I just get an indication here? We, you know, the Business Committee have agreed to meet at 1 o'clock. We can either take a reason till then or start this next section. See you nodding. Okay, well, then we'll proceed and go as far as we can. We now come to the third group of amendments for debate. With Amendment 27, it will be convenient to debate the other amendments in this group, which deal with the complaints handling procedure. Members should note that Amendments 46 and 47 are both consequential to Amendment 45. Amendment 48 is consequential to Amendment 47. Amendment 49 is consequential to Amendments 47 and 48. Amendment 51 is consequential to Amendments 46 and 48. Amendment 65 is consequential to Amendment 44. Amendment 67 is consequential to Amendment 47. Amendment 69 is consequential to Amendment 45. Amendment 71 is consequential to Amendment 44. And Amendment 75 is consequential to Amendment 45 to 52. And if all that is clear, I call the Chairperson of the Committee for the Office of OFM-DFM, Mr. Mike Nesbitt, to move Amendment 27 and to address the other amendments in this group. Mr. Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, thank you. I indeed rise to move Amendment 27 and address the other amendments in this final group. These amendments were brought forward by the OFM-DFM Committee in light of submissions which were received by the Ad Hoc Committee in relation to provisions for complaints handling procedures which were introduced in Scotland by the Public Services Reform Scotland Act of 2010. The Scottish Ombudsman made a submission to the Ad Hoc Committee and with reference to the Ombudsman's Complaint Standards Team, which implemented changes, the Ombudsman had this to say. This small team, working collaboratively with many others across the public services in Scotland, have arguably had greater impact on the day-to-day relationship between the public and public services than any other initiative undertaken by this office. The Ad Hoc Committee also sought the views of the Ombudsman on the proposal, who advised that his office's research suggested the need for common complaint standards, principles and procedures across the public sector in Northern Ireland. He believed that a complaint standards role for NIPSO would not only facilitate the development of complaints handling in Northern Ireland, but would also allow the Assembly and the Executive to make meaningful comparisons between the performance of bodies in each sector. In light, then, of the broad support for the proposal, the OFM-DFM Committee agreed to bring these amendments. While the cost of introducing these changes in Scotland was relatively modest, the Committee agreed to leave commencement of these provisions to the Assembly Commission, and that was in light of current and ongoing financial constraints, and with the hope that they will be commenced as soon as the necessary resources can be found reasonably. Amendment 27 replaces the phrase complaints procedure in Clause 24 with the phrase complaints handling procedure, as do Amendments 29, 30 to 33 and Amendment 35. These amendments pave the way for the new Part 3 of the Bill, which deals with complaints handling procedure, as indeed does Amendment 34. Amendments 44 to 52 inclusive introduce the new Part 3 into the Bill, and that's closely modelled on the system in place in Scotland. Amendment 44 defines the meaning of a complaints handling procedure. Amendment 45 requires the NIPSO to consult ministers and others on a draft statement of principles concerning complaints handling procedures and to have regard to any representations made. The NIPSO must then lay a draft statement of principles before the Assembly for approval and, subject to that approval, then publish it. And a similar process applies to any revision of those principles. Amendment 46 requires the listed authority to have a complaints handling procedure which complies with the statement of principles. Amendment 47 authorises NIPSO to publish model complaints handling procedures which comply with the statement of principles after consultation with such listed authorities and others as the NIPSO thinks fit. Any revisions, again, would follow a similar process. Amendment 48 provides that where the NIPSO specifies a listed authority to which a model complaints handling procedure or model CHP is relevant, then that authority must ensure that its procedure complies with the model CHP and send a description of its procedure to the NIPSO within 6 months. Amendment 49 provides that the NIPSO may make a declaration that a procedure doesn't comply with a specified model CHP or with the statement of principles. The NIPSO must give reasons and specify required modifications. And then a listed authority must resubmit its procedure within 2 months, having taken account of the modifications. Amendment 50 provides a general duty for a listed authority to submit a copy of its CHP to the NIPSO within 3 months of the NIPSO so directing, and such additional information in relation to the procedure as the NIPSO may reasonably request. Amendment 51 provides that the duties in Amendment 47 and 48 do not apply where this would be inconsistent with any other statutory provision, or the listed authority lacks the necessary powers to ensure compliance with the duties. Amendment 52 requires the NIPSO to monitor the complaints handling practices of listed authorities and identify trends, promote best practice, and encourage cooperation and the sharing of best practice. Listed authorities must cooperate with NIPSO in this regard unless they lack the power to do so, or so doing would be inconsistent with any other statutory provision. Mr. Speaker, let me just amend what I said. In terms of Amendment 51, it applies to duties in Amendments 46 and 48, not 47. Amendments 65, 67 and 69 point the reader towards the relevant provisions of the Bill, which define key terms dealing with complaints handling procedures. Amendment 71 provides for the commencement on the day after royal assent of the proposed new clause to be inserted by Amendment 44, which defines complaints handling procedure. This is necessary because the definition is required for other provisions of the Bill, not just the new Part 3. And finally, Mr. Speaker, Amendment 75 provides that the other provisions in the new proposed Part 3 of the Bill would come into operation on such day as the Assembly Commission may, by order, appoint. And that concludes my remarks on this third section of amendments.
Thank you, and I call the Lord Morrow, the Chairperson of the Ad Hoc Committee.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The Ad Hoc Committee did not have sight of these amendments prior to its formal clause-by-clause scrutiny, and therefore there is no Ad Hoc Committee position on these amendments. However, I do wish to outline briefly the Committee's consideration of the role of the NIPSO in respect of complaints handling procedure. The Committee noted ongoing communication between the Northern Ireland Ombudsman and the Committee for OFM-DFM in relation to the potential for the NIPSO to play a design authority role in the public sector complaints process, and noted indeed that this was one of the themes in the Committee for OFM-DFM's original consultation in 2010. The Committee noted that the Committee for OFM-DFM and the Ombudsman were initially of the view that the improvement of public complaint handling would be addressed through the investigation of complaints and resulting recommendations to the listed authorities involved, and noted that both were mindful of the potential resource implications for this additional role in the current financial climate. The Ad Hoc Committee received correspondence in June from the Ombudsman, which provided details of legislation introduced in Scotland in 2010 that provided for the Scottish Ombudsman to publish a model complaints handling procedure for listed authorities and to compel bodies to adopt the model complaints handling policy. The NI Ombudsman regards that this uniformity of approach to complaints across all public services is important, as the public are then aware of a simple, streamlined approach and their right to complain to the Ombudsman if they remain dissatisfied, having exhausted the internal process of the listed authority. The Ombudsman's Office published research into complaints handling in public sector bodies in 2014, and the report on this research highlighted the need for complaint standards procedures, given the confusion experienced by the public when attempting to negotiate what the Ombudsman referred to as the complaints maze. The Committee noted that the Ombudsman, as a result, now believes that such a complaints standards authority's role for the NIPSO would facilitate refinement and development in handling public sector complaints in Northern Ireland, and noted that the Committee for OFM-DFM, in consideration of the Ombudsman's views, now also sees merit in such a role for the NIPSO, modelled upon that of the Scottish Ombudsman and subject to commencement by the Assembly Commission, dependent on the availability of the resources for implementation. The Ad Hoc Committee noted these developments but did not have sight of the Committee for OFM-DFM's amendments on this additional role for the NIPSO prior to the formal clause-by-clause scrutiny and therefore did not take a view on these amendments. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
And the Business Committee is arranged to meet at 1 p.m. today, and I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to suspend the sitting until 2 p.m. The first item of business when we return will be question time. The sitting is, by leave, suspended. Thank you very much.
The stage of the Public Services Ombudsman Bill, and I call Chris Hazard.
I welcome the opportunity to speak at this stage of the bill. As a new member onto the committee, I have relied heavily upon the bill office and the committee staff for advice and guidance in the range and the depth and the remit of this bill, so thanks to them. My colleague Bronwyn McGahan, who is now in pastor's new, as they say. I think the Chair has outlined quite succinctly the remit of the extent of the amendments in Group 3, so I won't go into any great detail. Suffice to say, I think the experience of the ad hoc committee in making the suggestions and the relationship with the Scottish Ombudsman's Office, I think, highlights what can be done when departments and agencies work together. And I think this is something we'll be looking forward to, and such co-design is something that will be strengthened, I think, by the complaints procedure that is outlined in Part 3. I think there would have been some issue around the issues of cost, but I think it's welcome that the commencement will not begin until the Assembly Commission deems it is more economically wise to do so, as outlined in Amendment 75. Again, I would welcome this. But to a large extent, the amendments is really just a synchronising of terminology to pave the way for the new clause in Part 3. Into this, I think, if the wider principles of maximising the effect of redress and complaint, I think it is this Part 3 that is at the heart of the process and these amendments to do that. So I think it's suffice to say that Sinn Féin support each of the new amendments, including the new clauses, and look forward to rest for debate.
I now call the Deputy Chairperson of the Committee for the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, Mr. Chris Little, to wind on this Group 3 debate.
Thank you, Deputy Speaker. This has been a short debate in relation to this group of amendments, but I think it has been constructive, and I think these particular amendments are positive and, as members have mentioned, do demonstrate the good use that can be made of drawing from best practice in other jurisdictions on these islands. The amendments, as has been mentioned, will focus on complaints handling procedures. They've drawn from best practice in Scotland, such as the use of a small complaints standards team, common complaints standards, principles and procedures, model complaints handling procedures, and indeed the ability for the Ombudsman to compel good practice in complaints handling procedures with listed authorities. The chairperson of the OFM-DFM committee has set that out in capable detail. Lord Morrow, chairperson of the ad hoc committee, raised some concerns in relation to resource implications of these provisions, but also acknowledged that uniformity, consistency and clarity was needed for the public when presenting complaints about public services, and that he could see merit in these proposals whilst the ad hoc committee was not able to form a collective view at this stage. Chris Hazard has also referred to those provisions in a positive light, and I certainly give the support of the committee to these amendments. Thank you.
Amendment proposed to clause 24, page 9, line 22, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that amendment 27 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 28 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally amendment 28. Amendment proposed to clause 24, page 9, line 24, leave out and insert words as printed in the marshalled list. The question is that amendment 28 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 24, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 29 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 29.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 25, page 9, line 26, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 29 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 30 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 30.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 25, page 9, line 28, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 30 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 31 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 31.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 25, page 9, line 30, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 31 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 25 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 32 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 32.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 26, page 10, line 2, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 32 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 33 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 33.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 26, page 10, line 5, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 33 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 26, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 34 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 34.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 27, page 10, leave out subsections 1 and 2. The question is that Amendment 34 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 35 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 35.
Moved.
Amendment proposed clause 27, page 10, line 22, leave out insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 35 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 27, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 36 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 36.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 28, page 10, line 35, leave out insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 36 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 28, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clause 29. The question is that clause 29 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 37 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 37.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 30, page 11, line 36, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 37 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 38 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 38.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 30, page 12, line 1, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 38 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 30 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 39 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 39.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 31, page 12, line 12, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 39 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 40 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 40.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 31, page 12, line 16, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 40 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 41 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 41.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 31, page 12, line 24, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 41 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 31 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 42 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 42.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 32, page 12, line 38. Leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 42 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 32 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 43 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 43.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 33, page 13, line 6, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 43 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 33 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 44 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 44.
Moved.
Amendment proposed, after Clause 33, insert a new clause, meaning of complaints handling procedure, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 44 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 45 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 45.
Moved.
Amendment proposed, after Clause 33, insert a new clause, Statement of Principles, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 45 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 46 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 45. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 46.
Moved.
Amendment proposed, after Clause 33, insert a new clause, obligation for listed authority to have complaints handling procedure as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 46 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 47 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 47.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 33. Insert a new clause, Model Complaint Handling Procedures, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 47 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 48 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 47. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 48. Amendment proposed after Clause 33, insert a new clause, obligation for listed authority to comply with modelled CHPs as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 48 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 49 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendments 47 and 48. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 49.
Move.
Amendment proposed after Clause 33, insert a new clause, Declaration of Non-Compliance of Complaints Handling Procedures, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 49 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 50 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 50.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 33, insert a new clause, submission of description of complaint handling procedure, general, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 50 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 51 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendments 46 and 48. And I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 51.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 33, insert a new clause, application of other enactments as printed on the marshalled list. The question is Amendment 51 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 52 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 52.
Moved.
Amendment proposed after Clause 33, insert a new clause, promotion of best practice, etc., as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 52 be made and the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendment has been tabled to Clause 34. The question is that Clause 34 be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 53 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 53.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 35, page 14, line 5, leave out subsection 1, and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 53 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 54 has already been debated, and I call Mr Alistair to move formally Amendment 54. Amendment proposed to Clause 35, page 14, leave out subsections 1 to 4 and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 54 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I think the noes have it. The noes have it. The noes have it. The question is that clause 35 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clause 36. The question is that clause 36 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 55 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nisbet to move formally Amendment 55.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 37, page 14, line 24, after investigation, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 55 be made. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 37, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 56 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nisbet to move formally Amendment 56.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 38, page 14, line 35, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 56 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 38 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clause 39. The question is that clause 39 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clause 40. The question is that clause 40 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I think the ayes have it. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. Question put again in 3 minutes. Clear the lobbies. The question will be put again in 3 minutes. Order, members. Would members resume their seat? Order, members. Order, members. The question is that Clause 40 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. All those in favour say aye. Do we have tellers? Order, members. Order. Order, members. The following tellers have been appointed. Tellers for the ayes, Mike Nesbitt and Stephen Mutrie. Tellers for the noes, Katrina Ruan and Bronwyn McGahan. Clear the lobbies. The House will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Would members resume their seat? Could I ask members to resume their seat? Clerk, please read the result.
82 members voted. 58 members voted aye. 24 members voted no. Clause 40 stands part of the bill.
Clause 40 stands part of the bill. Unfasten the doors. Amendment 57 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 57.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 41, page 16, line 26, after give, insert written. The question is that Amendment 57 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 58 has already been debated, and I call Mr Alistair to move formally Amendment 58.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 41, page 17, line 1, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 58 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
I think the noes have it. I think the noes have it. The noes have it. The noes have it. Okay. I will not call Amendment 59 as it is consequential to Amendment 58, which has not been made. The question is that Clause 41 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
This is here. Okay. I have been advised by party whips in accordance with Standing Order 27.1A(b) that there is agreement that we can dispense with the 3 minutes and move straight to a division. So I now call for tellers. Do we have tellers? Order, members. The following tellers have been appointed. Tellers for the ayes, Mike Nesbitt and Stephen Mutray. Tellers for the noes, Bronwyn McGahan and Ian Milne. Clear the lobbies. The House will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Secure the doors. Would members resume their seat? Order, members. Clerk, please read the result.
79 members voted, 55 members voted aye, 24 members voted no. Clause 41 stands part of the bill.
Motion is carried. Clause 41 stands part of the bill. Amendment 60 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 60.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 42, page 17, line 38, at N, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 60 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 42, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to clauses 43 to 46. I propose by leave of the Assembly to group these clauses for the question on stand part. The question is that clauses 43 to 46 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 61 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 61.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 47, page 19, line 27, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 61 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 47 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 62 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 62.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 48, page 19, line 35, leave out words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 62 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 48 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 63 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 63.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 49, page 20, line 11, and then insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 63 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that clause 49 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 64 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 64.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 50, page 20, line 15, at the end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 64 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 65 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 44, which has been agreed to. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 65.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 50, page 20, line 16, at end insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 65 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 66 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 66.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 50, page 20, leave out lines 34, 38, and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 66 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 67 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 47, which has been agreed to. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 67.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to clause 50, page 20, line 38, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 67 be made. All those in favour say aye. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 68 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 68. Amendment proposed, clause 50, page 20, line 38, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is Amendment 68 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 69 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 45, which has been agreed to. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 69. Amendment proposed to clause 50, page 21, line 1, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 69 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 50 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 51. The question is that Clause 51 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 70 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 70.
Moved.
Amendment proposed, after Clause 51, insert a new clause, orders as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 70 be made and that the new clause be added to the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The Chairman of the Committee for the Office of the First Minister and Deputy First Minister, Mr Nesbitt's opposition to Clause 52 has already been debated. But the question will be put in the positive as usual. The question is that Clause 52 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The noes have it. The noes have it. No amendment has been tabled to clauses 53 or 54. I propose, by leave of the Assembly, to group these clauses for the question on stand part. The question is that clauses 53 and 54 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 71 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 44. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 71.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 55, page 21, line 31, at N, insert words printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 71 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 72 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 72. Amendment proposed to Clause 55, page 22, line 2, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 72 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 73 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 73.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 55, page 22, line 3, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 73 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 74 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 74.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 55, page 22, line 33, sorry, 23, line 23, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 74 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 75 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendments 45 to 52, which have been made. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 75.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Clause 55, page 22, line 23, at N, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 75 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Clause 55 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 76 has already been debated, and I call Pat Sheehan to move formally Amendment 76. Amendment proposed to Clause 56, page 22, line 25, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 76 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no.
No.
I think the noes have it. I think the noes have it. The noes have it. The noes have it. The question is that Clause 56, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Clause 57. The question is that Clause 57 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 77 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 77.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 1, page 23, line 5, at N, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 77 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 78 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 78.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 1, page 24, line 40, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 78 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 79 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 79.
Good.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 1, page 27, line 4, at N, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 79 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 80 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 80. Amendment proposed to Schedule 1, page 27, line 19, leave out subparagraph 5. The question is that Amendment 80 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Schedule 1, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. That's page 70 next to that. Amendments 81 to 91 have already been debated, and are technical amendments to Schedule 2. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to group these amendments for the question. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally amendments 81 to 91.
Moved.
Amendments proposed to Schedule 2 as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that amendments 81 to 91 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 92 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 92.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 2, page 31, line 3, leave out subparagraph 2 and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 92 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendments 93 to 100 have already been debated and are technical amendments to Schedule 2. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to group these amendments for the question. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally amendments 93 to 100.
Moved.
Amendments proposed to Schedule 2 as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that amendments 93 to 100 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Schedule 2 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 101 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 101.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 32, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 101 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 102 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 102.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 32, line 29, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 102 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 103 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 103.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 32, line 31, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 103 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 104 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 104.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 33, line 10, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 104 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 105 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 105.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 33, leave out lines 30 to 32. The question is that Amendment 105 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 106 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 106.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 34, line 26, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 106 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 107 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 107.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 34, leave out line 32. The question is that Amendment 107 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 108 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 24, which has already been agreed to. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 108.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 3, page 35, leave out lines 2 and 3. The question is that Amendment 108 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Schedule 3, as amended, stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Thank you for bearing with me. I'm just seeking some advice there. Amendment 109 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 109.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 4, page 35, line 30. Leave out and insert words as printed on the Marshal's list. The question is that Amendment 109 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Schedule 4 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 110 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 110.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 5, page 36, leave out paragraph 3. The question is that Amendment 110 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 111 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 111.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 5, page 36, line 31, leave out sub-paragraph 2 and insert words as printed on the Marshal's list. The question is that Amendment 111 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Schedule 5 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 112 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 112.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 6, page 39, line 27, at end insert words as printed on the Marshal's list. The question is that Amendment 112 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendments 113 and 114 have already been debated and are technical amendments to Schedule 6. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to group these amendments for the question. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendments 113 and 114.
Not moved.
Not moved.
Okay. Still as amended.
Okay.
There was one later.
The question is that Schedule 6 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 115 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 115.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 40, line 7, leave out paragraph 2. The question is that Amendment 115 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 116 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 116.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 40, line 19, at end insert words as printed on the Marshal's list. The question is that Amendment 116 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 117 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 117.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 40, line 19, at end insert words as printed on the Marshal's list. The question is that Amendment 117 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 118 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 118.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 40, line 19, at end insert words as printed on the Marshal's list. The question is that Amendment 118 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 119 has already been debated and is mutually exclusive with Amendment 120. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 119.
Not moved.
Amendment not moved. Amendment 120 has already been debated and is mutually exclusive with 119, which was not made. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 120.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 40, leave out line 22 and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 120 be made. All those in favour say aye. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendments 121 to 123 have already been debated, and all propose changing references from Ombudsperson to Commissioner in Schedule 7. I propose, therefore, by leave of the Assembly, to group these amendments for the question. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendments 121 to 123. Amendments proposed to Schedule 7, as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendments 121 to 123 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 124 has already been debated. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 124.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 41, leave out lines 10 to 12 and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 124 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 125 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 125.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 41, line 16, leave out and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 125 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 126 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 126.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 41, leave out lines 18 and 19. The question is that Amendment 126 be made. All those in favour say aye. Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 127 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 127.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 41, line 21, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 127 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 128 has already been debated and is consequential to Amendment 115. I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 128.
Moved.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 7, page 41, leave out line 27 and insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 128 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Schedule 7 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. No amendments have been tabled to Schedule 8. The question is that Schedule 8 stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendment 129 has already been debated, and I call Mr Nesbitt to move formally Amendment 129.
Moved, Deputy Speaker.
Amendment proposed to Schedule 9, page 46, line 40, at end, insert words as printed on the marshalled list. The question is that Amendment 129 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that Schedule 9 as amended stand part of the bill. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. Amendments 130 and 131 have already been debated. I propose, by leave of the Assembly, to group these amendments for the question. I call Pat Sheehan to move formally amendments 130 and 131.
Moved.
Amendments proposed to the long title leave out Ombudsperson and insert Ombudsman. The question is that amendments 130 and 131 be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
Aye.
All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. I think the ayes have it. I think the ayes have it. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The question is that the long title as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it. And that concludes the consideration stage of the Public Services Ombudsperson Bill. The bill stands referred to the Speaker. And could I ask members to take their ease for a few moments.